Hello, everyone. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Susan Feng, editor-in-chief of BePush News. As we all know that as social media's continue rise, it seems very difficult to find the truth. The truth is difficult to find, difficult to hide, but it's more important than ever. So how to sort out the facts from misinformation and how to tell the truth from lies and how to interact each other more efficiently on internet and how blockchain will help us build truth again and how young people can find opportunities during this process. Today, we are very fortunate to have a distinguished speaker, Eric Li, to join us. Eric, welcome.
Thank you, Susan. It's great to be with you today.
Yeah, Eric, you co-founded LinkedIn in 2003, and now you founding another blockchain project hub. So tell us a little bit about yourself. What motivated you to co-found LinkedIn?
Yeah, LinkedIn was founded almost 20 years ago. It's hard to believe. But it was founded during a time when it was hard to imagine anyone putting so much of their personal information online. These
Yes.
days, there's so much of our information and our identities online that it's very normal. So when we started LinkedIn, its goal was to really put our professional reputation and our professional network online. From that, I realized actually, fast forward 20 years that there was more to be done.
Okay.
And what I realized was that the success of LinkedIn and other social networks really created a problem. There was so much information created by so many people that it was hard to know whether someone's information was true and accurate.
Yes.
And Hub was really an attempt to, fix these problems.
Cool. So did you feel you see the next big thing?
Basically, the problem was that we've come to rely on so much of this information to make decisions about ourselves.
Yes.
And in the case of LinkedIn, it was really information about the people that we rely on, or information that we rely on to create business with. Do we want to have a relationship with someone professionally? Do we want to hire them? We're making important decisions about this information. So Hub is an attempt to, fix this problem where people might not be completely accurate about themselves.
Yeah,
And
absolutely. Yeah, back
yeah.
in I know LinkedIn was founded in 2003. Back then, in the early days of internet, we all see these big tech giants as the force that make the world of more open and prosperous place. A place like Google obviously said, they will not do evil. And also, but right now the public opinion shifted dramatically. People raise concern about this big tech's size and power, the handling of information, like Facebook's the scan data scandal. So from early on to now, so as you, as a pioneer of internet, how did you see internet evolve over time?
So technology has really become too much of a good thing.
Yeah.
So while it's brought great value to everybody's lives
Yes.
in terms of convenience and knowledge, this progress has really shown some of the serious problems that
Yes.
exist with the technology today. So basically, what we found is that this data about people's information
Yeah.
and behavior is really valuable. And the fact that its value is often put at risk because of our lack of understanding in terms of how to manage it. And so today we don't really have the necessary tools to effectively deal with this data yet, and we need to figure out solutions so that we can continue to expand the value of this technology and this data while doing it without the problems that really the technology has created on its own.
Yeah, you mentioned the problem. It's of course the problem. Like nowadays, as social media rise, everybody can be a news anchor, and it's everybody, you can have the impact on the society, like big news media outlet. So like some radical news organization have the same impact as New York Times. And it's not only in the United States, you know, China, everywhere, it seems it's a world problem, but no, not even mentioned in the United States. During the election, we can see the lies and conspiracy theory flooding on the internet. So how do you think the big platform like Twitter, Facebook, Google, all these tech giants, what's their responsibility and duty to deal with this problem? We know that Facebook, Twitter, you give them some credit, they take down and label the false information, but obviously it's not enough.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. You know, the thing is that, you know, I do believe that technology companies, just like any other company, they have a responsibility to offer products that are, you know, beneficial and valuable, you know, to people. And in the case of social media companies, it's actually a very challenging goal to achieve this, because it is sometimes very difficult to know what is fact and what is fiction.
Yes.
And so, you know, if the companies in our industry, you know, cannot stop disinformation from being spread, they should actually try to be explicit about the factual basis of this information itself, so people can decide on whether the information that they're getting is valid or not, right? And so this means, I believe, associating with the information that they're getting, whether the content is coming from a reputable source or, you know, is the information, as they can tell, factual, you know, or not. And so this is, I think, you know, what they have to do to help people interpret the information to decide whether it's accurate or not.
It seems a lot to ask, but think how much they make money from our data, right? And also, as I know, some scholars, they suggest that to tax these big platforms, you know, to as tobacco industry, because as same as tobacco industry, they send out a lot of you know, bad information, you know, harmful information, you know, spread around the society. And also right now in the United States, Google, Amazon, Facebook, Apple, they all face antitrust and privacy lawsuit from US government. And China also launched an antitrust probe on Alibaba. So what's your thought on that?
Well, you know, regulation is, you know, often considered undesirable by companies because they feel like it, you know, infringes on their profit motive. But I do believe that, you know, it's useful to set some boundaries so that companies can play where, you know, it is safe. You know, my only hope is that in terms of regulations that are made, when they're made by, you know, leaders in the government, they are well informed and enlightened about the technology so that they, you know, don't limit the industry unnecessarily, because these industries do contribute economic value to people as a whole.
Yeah, that seems, you know, I and of course, you know, if without this kind of company, we cannot work, you know, during this pandemic, right? Because of the internet, because of Google, because Amazon, you know, we can work in this pandemic, we can buy things remotely. Obviously, they contribute a lot economically to society. But right now, the misinformation really let the society pay a big price for that.
Yeah, you know, it's really interesting because, you know, you have to often wonder, you know, what is at stake, right? Sometimes people think, oh, it's okay if people, you know, believe things that are, you know, not necessarily true. But I was reading recently about some of the statistics around misinformation. You know, there was a recent article in the New York Times that talked about how the engagement of articles that have false information on Facebook has tripled since 2016, when there was the last U.S. election, when people became aware of this problem. I think the
Yes.
most recent example is really alarming in terms of the information surrounding COVID and the pandemic. You know, there have been some recent surveys that have been done, and they say that 4 out of 10 Americans believe that you know, COVID is a conspiracy,
Yes.
which is, you know, very alarming. And then, you know,
And also
even
people say a lot of things about the mask. People say mask is not useful and the vaccine.
That's right. That's right. There's a, you know, a significant number of Americans who don't want to take the vaccine. So, you know, this is an instance where the misinformation itself is actually going to harm people and cause more deaths, right? So it's not just oh, you know, just some kind of unimportant
It's real,
thing.
real harmful.
That's right. So I think that's why, you know, in matters of you know, health today, especially with the coronavirus, and you know, when we started this project around Hub, we actually felt that, you know, economic opportunities and financial opportunities were, you know, really important and should be improved. And that's really, you know, based on having, you know, accurate information about the people that we work with.
But, you know, we see that because the data algorithm is a key to for the business or for the profit of these big platforms. Actually, you're spreading the misinformation to help people on, keep people on this platform. So if you ask the big tech giants to take down this information, to take very harsh attitude, very strict on this information, in the end, actually, it hurt that business. Do you think it's like a little bit contrary for that business instinct? You know, they will do that, you know, for society's benefit. But if they're really serious about it, it will decrease people's spend time on the platform. It will not good for that data.
Well, you know, unfortunately, you know, it's human nature for people to hear what they want to believe, right? And they want to believe things, you know, whether it is true or not, as long as it sort of promotes their own, you know, belief. And, you know, for these technology platforms, in an effort to promote engagement, they've made it easy for people to see the information that they want to see. And, but I do believe that the problem right now is it's really just a limitation that these platforms have, but I do believe that they, you know, we should find ways to solve these limitations and to make these platforms better.
Okay, great. Just as you said, you know, people want to listen what they believe. So actually, the social media, instead of connecting people, they separate people. It's like only people have similar opinion, they form a group. They don't talk with the other group. And it makes the society even more divided, you know.
Yeah, that's right. You know, that's, you know, I think one of the things that happened on Facebook, where, you know, back 4 years ago, I think there was a big push to, you know, have people, you know, be more connected with their community, with their friends and family. And but one of the unfortunate side effects of that was that, you know, people became attached to these more intimate groups, where they can share information among people that had similar, you know, beliefs that they did without necessarily being exposed to kind of the larger, you know, more verified information that was out there, the news, by, you know, reputable sources. And so as a result, what happened was that, you know, these factions formed between people that were almost kind of like echo chambers for themselves.
Yeah,
right?
Because
so
it's even very obvious on WeChat. We only want to listen what we believe.
Yeah, that's right. And so unfortunately, I think, you know, people have become, you know, more and more divided than they ever have, you know, before. And it's because of, I think, you know, some unintended consequences of this technology that have gotten us here. And so I do believe that there's more work to be done to really fix these problems that are upon us today.
And the data nowadays, no matter where you live, people in this world, all our life are dominated by this data, by the big platform. They know where you are, what you like, who you love, and where you travel. Everywhere, our data is on that platform. So, and they make huge profit of owning our own data using the algorithm. So, what kind of rights do you think the user have over our own data?
Well, I think there's really no doubt that data has become kind of a new currency.
Yes.
In this new economy that we all live in, it has value. Mm-hmm. And right now, that data has been redeemed by the tech giants.
Yes.
And consumers, they gain relatively little from their data, except maybe for the free use of the platform.
Yeah.
And even then, that is a controversial, idea. This is a very inequitable distribution of value, coming from the data. And having grown up in a capitalist society and being a capitalist myself, I actually believe that we should reward people for the value of their hard work, these entrepreneurs, but at the same time, I do believe also that we should redistribute the value that this data has. So that it's more equitable, between people. And so people should, actually benefit from more of the value of their data rather than kind of the, big corporations always, gaining from the value of this data.
But how will blockchain help? How like individual user can own our data? So will blockchain help?
Well, one of the very interesting things about blockchain is that it really promotes this idea, of decentralization.
Mm-hmm.
I think as I've studied, blockchain over the years, it is in this idea of decentralization that I think some of these major problems with big tech today, can be solved. First of all, you have the ownership of the data that is really owned by the big technology companies today.
Yeah.
With blockchain, you have the ability to actually, decentralize the ownership of data so that people can take their data wherever they want to, go and benefit from it. They in effect can have ownership of their data.
Yeah.
And that's a very valuable thing that is kind of the first step in, gaining from the value of that data.
That's cool. The first step that you own the data, but another step is the trust. We know that right now. Have you heard that Alibaba they sell the old customers? They price higher to the old customers than to the new customers. So how can you believe these tech giants? How people to build the trust? It seems hard to believe the tech giants, and it's also seems hard to trust everyone, every person we met meet on this internet. So what's the solution?
Well, I think the reality is that the world is becoming, a bigger and bigger place with many more actors that we have to interact with, right? So it's going to be hard to, as they say, put the genie back into the bottle.
Yes.
So there's going to be, a new reality where there's more people that we have to deal with. So I think the question is, how do we use technology to help us, gain trust, with, more and more entities rather than, fewer and fewer entities. And so I think that, once again, I think technology can be a solution, but it has to be, done in the right way. And part of, what, I've been trying to do,
mm-hmm.
At Hub is to really, look at how we can properly track information You know, one of the key ideas that I'm interested in is how do we get, you know, verified information. So, you know, if we're able to verify that a piece of information is true, then we're more likely to trust it, and we're more likely to be able to make good decisions, you know, based on that. And so I think that's one of the other benefits of blockchain as well, is that once we're able to capture a piece of information and know that it's verified, we can depend on it, and you know, we can make good decisions based on it.
Okay, cool. So, but do you, because I read information about the hub, you know, you said the challenge from of the lack of trust will only get worse as people increasingly turn to internet for small interaction. And you folks, hubs focus a lot on reputation and identity. It seems you try to build up users' reputation score to help people interact more efficiently. Could you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, you know, it's very much of the same themes as, you know, we've been, you know, discussing. And so, you know, what we want to do, first of all, is we want to capture information about, you know, people. This is, you know, simply described as reputation, but we want to capture in a way that information is verified and is, you know, truthful, because without good information about people, it's hard to form good opinions about them. So that's the first thing.
Yeah.
The second thing that we want to do is to, you know, make it possible using blockchain technologies to enable that information to really be owned by, you know, people. And what that means is that they can take it anywhere that they want to go, so it's not
so
locked up.
They can take their own personal data and the credit score to go from one marketplace to another.
That's right, and I think this is the key to sort of, you know, breaking up the control that you know, big tech has around the data that's owned by individuals, because we know that that information is valuable,
yes,
but we want to, you know, place the control of that information into the hands of users, and by doing that, we enable them to, you know, be in control and to benefit from that information, rather than the you know, big tech companies you know, benefiting from it. So I don't want to say that, you know, companies should not benefit from that information, but I think more of a equitable distribution in terms of the value is going to be you know, better for, you know, everyone.
But how did you get started with blockchain? It's because you are pioneering internet, now you are pioneering blockchain. So how did this idea come to you?
Well, you know, it comes from, you know, I think seeing some of the, you know, problems that exist today on the internet. And you do see that in general, some of the limitations, we've really reached some of the limits. In terms of what we're able to do with today's technology. So as an entrepreneur, as a, you know, person who is, you know, looking to solve problems, I was always, you know, looking for, you know, new tools and to solve existing problems that I, you know, see. And so I think the real kind of advantage of blockchain is that you see it as a new tool to solve some of these really challenging problems that exist with internet technologies today. So I'm actually very excited to, you know, work on blockchain, because it really provides the answers for some of these really challenging problems.
But how do you, could you give us a lot of young people, you know, like you, a lot of young people are also looking for the next big thing. They want to be part of them. Do you have some suggestions for young people, you know, what they should do? How do they find a new career opportunity? How do they find the next big thing? Are you in Chinese, 下一个风口会在哪里? Yeah,
that's a great question. I would say to, you know, look for opportunities that can have a positive impact on a lot of people. And also on look for, you know, opportunities that you can solve, right? So there's basically two places to look. You can always look for opportunities to solve existing problems in a better way, or you can look for new problems that you have a solution for. I mean, those
Yeah.
are the two ways to, have opportunities that are, really worthwhile. And there's never a shortage of problems, even
Yes.
though it might seem that, all the problems have been solved, but that's never true. So
Yeah.
the best advice I always got was, to apply yourself, and that you are very capable. So I believe that everyone is very capable. They always have something to offer, and it's a matter of finding what it is that you can apply yourself to.
Yeah, but Anna, do you you can use it's like that, in you're a tech person, you went to Stanford University. So how did you find your opportunity?
I think it's important to engage and interact with other entrepreneurs. I was very lucky growing up in Silicon Valley that there was always people who always talking about new ideas and new dreams and new companies, and always being in the midst of other people who were always trying to push the boundaries. And here in Silicon Valley, there's quite a rich kind of entrepreneurial spirit. And I think it's really great to be in a culture like that. So I definitely encourage people to, find people who are like that, who are always exploring new things, because in doing so, it will give you ideas of your own that you can solve that, will also make you very successful.
But do you have a philosophy by which to live?
I would say be open, and always, be, open to new opportunities as they come to you. It's, very important to keep an eye out on new challenges, and always to look to the future and not necessarily so much the past.
Okay, that sounds great. Thank you so much, Eric.
Thank you, Susan. It's a pleasure to talk to you today.
Yeah, now let's look at some questions people have.